everyone, and welcome to Kevin's Seventh Heaven. Now you may be noticing that there's something different about me, and it's that I have this weird Dr. Seuss-like instrument in my hands. I'll lean back a little bit so you can see. This is my Kahn 1914 double bell euphonium. Now you may have heard of the double bell euphonium, but you weren't listening very carefully when you heard it. It shows up in one of the verses in 76 Trombones, which is in the musical The Music Man. In fact, many of you out there may be wondering what the heck a euphonium even is. You've heard of trumpets, French horns, trombones, and tubas, but the word euphonium may be foreign to you. To truly describe my instrument, I'm going to familiarize you with two terms, baritone horn and euphonium. My mom likes to call both of these instruments baby tubas, and you can see why. It kind of looks like a mini-me tuba. Euphoniums and baritones do share one characteristic with tubas, and that is they are conical in nature. That means from mouthpiece to bell, throughout the whole instrument, the piping is gradually flaring out to give a mellow sound. However, the baritone horn is a narrower piping, a narrower gauge of piping, which means it has a slightly brighter tone than a euphonium does. The double bell euphonium was an attempt to put the two together into one instrument. The larger bell up here acts as the euphonium component, while the smaller bell is the baritone part. The four valves here, 1, 2, 3, and 4, are what you use to play the instrument, and this fifth valve down here is what you use to switch between the two bells. In practice, they have become basically mostly interesting looking heavier euphoniums, as players rarely switch over to the smaller bell. In fact, Arthur W. Lehman, euphonium soloist for the Marine Band from 1947 to 1964, said of the smaller bell, "We use it to hold our white gloves when we are not wearing them." The first ones were made by Kahn in the 1880s, and the last ones were made around 1960. I've seen military ones that were used at in the Shrine of Music Museum in Vermilion, South Dakota, which is an astounding, wonderful museum to visit. I suggest you all go do it at some point in your lives. Now, you're wondering, Kevin, how the heck did you get one of these instruments? Well, I'll tell you, this is a very powerful and wonderful family heirloom. My great-grandfather played it, my grand-uncle played it, and my grandmother played it. And as the brass player in the extended family, it was passed down to me. Now, over time, saliva from the other players had corroded holes into it. And that meant my Aunt Kelly made sure that it was properly repaired and is very playable. I will admit, it is an old instrument, and it was kind of almost a novelty instrument to begin with, so it may not play as nice as a modern euphonium does. But I love it a lot, and I would have to be in desperate need to even consider selling it. Now, I want to show you a bit of what it sounds like in a nice, beautiful melody. So here is Going Home by Anton Dvorak. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed learning about my odd, wonderful instrument, and that it has whet your appetite for more music diversity in this world. This world is not just all guitars and violins and trumpets. There's a myriad of sound and experience out there. Sometime in the future, I will introduce you to my Taisho Goto, and we will once sometime have a meditative experience with my Shruti box. On Wednesday, we will be looking at an interesting word, and on Friday, we will be doing another poetry reading and examination. Anyway, ta-ta for now. Love you all.